Psalm 33:12 says, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord." That was originally written about the nation of Israel, but it has a wider application, especially in the Christian era. Psalm 33 goes on to say, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place he watches all who live on earth. He who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do." So God looks at all the nations of the earth, but blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Have you noticed which nations have been the most prosperous with the most blessings? The United States has been the most prosperous nation historically for centuries, and it has also been the place with the most Bible-believing Christians. Could that be a mere coincidence? There are other countries in Europe and South America where formalistic ritual Christianity prevails, and they have tended to be second to the United States in prosperity. And then there are the countries of Asia and Africa that spent most of their history in paganism without accepting the gospel of Christ, and they have tended to be the poorest and most unstable nations of the world. There are exceptions, of course, but this seems to be the general rule, that the most Bible-believing countries have been the most prosperous, with America at the very top as the envy of the rest of the world. That's a key thought to keep in mind at this particular time in our nation's history. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord.
Welcome to Bible Nook's worship service. Pastor David Reed has authored numerous books, served as a contributing editor of Dr. Walter Martin's Christian Research Journal, taught at Spurgeon's in London, and pastored Emmanuel Baptist Church in New Bedford, Massachusetts. He now provides these worship services for individuals at home and free to use by small groups and churches.
Let's ask the Lord's blessing on our service. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of turning to your word, the Bible, for guidance and for encouragement and for instruction and for hope for the future. We thank you, Lord, for the word that you've provided and preserved down through the centuries so that we can know your mind on matters and not be influenced just by those around us. We thank you too, Lord, for this opportunity to come together to worship you and to lift our voices in songs of praise to you. We pray your blessing on this gathering, even though it's a virtual one, and we pray your blessing on each one who joins us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's join together in singing "My Country, 'Tis of Thee."
Awake! Let all that breathe partake. Let rocks and silence break the sound prolonged. Our fathers, God, to thee offer of liberty. To thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's only light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King.
Some 2,000 years ago, Jesus' disciples gathered around him and asked him to teach them how to pray. And the answer that he gave was the Lord's Prayer, the Our Father prayer, that Christians have been repeating down through the centuries. Let's join our hearts and our voices together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This Bible Nook ministry hosts a weekly remote Bible study and prayer meeting during the months from September through June. It's on summer recess currently, but will resume the first Wednesday in September. Bible Nook also provides free online resources in the form of websites at a dozen different domains. At the TOB Bible domain, we provide a free modern Bible translation that's copyright free and that can be used online or even purchased in printed form. The Bible we provide at BibleForTheEndTimes.com can be read online or downloaded for free and features footnotes highlighting and discussing passages on the end times, the last days of this world, and other important prophecies. At doorstepbible.com, we provide a free Bible in digital PDF format that's also available in print, with footnotes that enable you to answer Mormons and answer Jehovah's Witnesses when they come to your door. Our answerjw.com website provides other extensive resources on that cult, including a free online version of the book, How to Rescue Your Loved One from the Watchtower. Our leftbehindanswered.com website examines the Bible verses related to that controversial new teaching. And our unversusil.com website explores the roles of Israel and the United Nations in end times prophecy. Our comefollowjesus.net site offers an introduction to biblical Christianity for non-believers and new believers, and for all of us to review the basics of our beliefs. And our main website, BibleNook.com, provides links to all of the sites I just mentioned and features lots of other helpful material. Our videos of worship services and individual messages remain available for streaming at YouTube.com/BibleNook and at Facebook.com/BibleNookMinistry. These live streamed services are aimed at providing traditional worship services for believers who otherwise would not have them because they're confined to the home or because they don't have a nearby church that sings traditional hymns and preaches Bible messages. And they're also aimed at reaching the world with messages proclaiming and upholding the gospel of Christ. We pay Facebook to boost our messages, and we pay Google to advertise our YouTube messages. with the result that the thought-provoking thumbnails, some of which you see here, reach millions of people. Toward the end of 2023, Facebook and Google reported more than 250,000 total views for our message on Israel and Armageddon. A flood of responses and comments, including from many non-believers, and many comments from inside Israel itself, proved that this video got many people thinking and talking about the gospel message. The 250,000 views reported for that message shows that for a very small ministry with a very small budget, Bible Nook reaches a very large audience. During the year 2023, we received gifts totaling $5,326, and we spent $5,875 on web hosting and domains, post office expenses, Zoom, and our call-in conference line. But overwhelmingly, we spent that money on boosting messages on Facebook and YouTube. As you can see, we had a shortfall for the year of $549, but my wife and I were glad to cover that from our own personal funds to keep boosting messages that were generating so much interest. No one takes any salary from Bible Nook. To maintain our freedom of speech, we have not applied to the government for their approval as a ministry. But all the gifts we receive go directly to the expense of spreading Bible messages. If you're being blessed by this ministry, or if the Lord moves your heart to spend some of your resources on our gospel outreach, you can do so by visiting BibleNook.com and clicking the donate button on the home page, or by sending a check to Bible Nook, 214 Onset Ave, Suite 1464, Onset, Massachusetts, 02558. Today's scripture reading is from Psalm 33, beginning with verse 8. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever, the purposes of his heart through all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place he watches all who live on earth, and he forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do. No king is saved by the size of his army. No warrior escapes by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance, despite all its great strength it cannot save. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. May the Lord add his blessing to our reading of his word. Now let's join in singing together the Battle Hymn of the Republic.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is tramping out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, alleluia. Glory, glory, alleluia. Glory, glory, alleluia. His truth is marching on. I have have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His day is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Our God is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea. With the glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. While God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. While God is marching on.
The 33rd Psalm says, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord." That was originally written about the nation of Israel, but it has a wider application, especially in the Christian era. Psalm 33 goes on to say, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place he watches all who live on earth. He who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do." So God looks at all the nations of the earth. But blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Have you noticed which nations have been the most prosperous with the most blessings? The United States has been the most prosperous nation historically for centuries, and it has also been the place with the most Bible-believing Christians. Could that be a mere coincidence? There are other countries in Europe and South America where formalistic ritual Christianity prevails, and they have tended to be second to the United States in prosperity. And then there are the countries of Asia and Africa that spent most of their history in paganism without accepting the gospel of Christ, and they have tended to be the poorest and the most unstable nations of the world. There are exceptions, of course, but this seems to be the general rule that the most Bible-believing countries have been the most prosperous, with America at the very top as the envy of the rest of the world. That's a key thought to keep in mind at this particular time in our nation's history. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. In just a few days, we'll all be celebrating the 4th of July, also known as Independence Day. But how many know its meaning, and how many know its Christian significance? People have a tendency to name holidays after a date on the calendar. For example, many folks in this country celebrated Cinco de Mayo on May 5th. Cinco de Mayo is actually Spanish for that date, the 5th of May. But how many know that it celebrates a victory of the Mexican army over French invaders? France took advantage of America's distraction during our Civil War to invade Mexico with a force of 30,000 French soldiers. The Cinco de Mayo holiday commemorates a Mexican victory over the French on May 5, 1862. Here in the USA, Cinco de Mayo is an occasion to honor Mexican culture, although the holiday is not really a big deal in Mexico itself. But the 4th of July is a big deal here in this country, a time for family cookouts and community fireworks displays. And it's a big deal because it celebrates the founding of this country. It was on the 4th of July, back in the year 1776, that the declaration establishing this nation was officially signed and took effect. Before that, we were 13 separate British colonies ruled over by the King of England. Not far from where I'm sitting, there are street signs marking sections of road as the King's Highway. They are remnants of the old King's Highway system from the 1600s that long preceded our modern state highways and interstates. And they're reminders that our East Coast was under British rule for more than 150 years. But after that first Independence Day, we were the United States of America. Our country came into being on that day. And so it was a big deal, and it continues to be a big deal. But I mentioned a moment ago that the 4th of July also has great Christian significance too. And that's because our founding fathers and the founding documents they created specified that they were setting up a Christian country, a Christian nation. It's popular today for people to deny that we started out as a Christian country. But the documented evidence still exists. One of those documents is the Declaration of Independence that was officially signed on July 4th, 1776. But it wasn't the first or the oldest document testifying to the Christian foundation of this nation. Over 150 years earlier, there was the Mayflower Compact. It was drawn up and signed aboard the Mayflower while it anchored off our coast before its people came ashore to found the town of Plymouth, Massachusetts. The ship was still off the tip of Cape Cod, near what's now Provincetown, when 41 men on board signed this document, dated November 11th, 1620. The only other British colony so far in North America at that time was located in Virginia. So they referred to Massachusetts as the northern parts of Virginia. But as we read part of it, notice what it said about God and about the Christian purpose of their voyage to the New World. The Mayflower Compact begins like this. In the name of God, amen. We, whose names are underwritten, the loyal subjects of our dread sovereign Lord King James, by the grace of God, of Great Britain, France, and Ireland, King, Defender of the Faith, etc., having undertaken for the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith and the honor of our King and country, a voyage to plant the first colony in the northern parts of Virginia, do by these presents, solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one another, covenant and combine ourselves together into a civil body politic. Notice that they started off their document almost as if it was a prayer by saying, in the name of God, amen. And then they referred to the British king who granted them permission to set up the new colony as ruling by the grace of God. By the way, that King James who commissioned them to settle here in 1620 was the very same King James who commissioned the King James Version of the Bible in 1611. The Mayflower Compact the Pilgrims signed is seldom quoted today, but that King James Bible is still in use and is quoted countless times every day, even now, over 400 years after it was published. The men who were about to leave the Mayflower to build the town of Plymouth, Massachusetts, continued their document by stating that the purpose of settling this new colony was, quote, for the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith, unquote. What plainer evidence could there be that the land we live in today was settled by people who came here for the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith? They said so themselves, and their words are preserved for us to this very day in that document. And then they further stated that they were signing the document in the presence of God and one another. They had a strong sense of God being present with them, watching what they were doing as they signed a document to set up a government for themselves and their descendants. From where I live, it's a short drive to the town of Plymouth, where you can see a replica of the Mayflower in the harbor where they dropped anchor, and see the very spot where they built their first homes in this new land that they came to, for the very express purpose, as they said, for the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith. If anyone today asserts that this country was not settled and established for that very reason, they're ignoring this founding document, which testifies against them. The settlers who arrived on the Mayflower certainly had in mind the advancement of the Christian faith in this new land. 150 years later, there were 13 British colonies all up and down the east coast of North America. And those colonies, too, were settled mainly by Bible-believing Christians. Conflict with the British government across the Atlantic led to a growing desire to separate from the old country and declare independence. The Declaration of Independence that representatives from each colony signed on July 4, 1776, listed dozens of serious grievances that the British government ignored, and it was those grievances that led to the separation. But the reason that we're looking at the Declaration of Independence is because of what it reveals about the Christian foundation of this new nation. The Declaration of Independence begins with these famous words: when in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands that have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. So they base their right to an independent nation on what they called the laws of nature and of nature's God. And by the term nature's God, they made plain that they meant God the creator of nature in the world around us. They were from Bible-reading families, and they grew up knowing the Genesis account of the God of the Bible also creating the whole human race from one original married couple, Adam and Eve. And that's what they were referring to when they wrote further in this Declaration of Independence: we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So this new country declared that its independence was based on the laws of God, the Creator, the God of the Bible. This Declaration of Independence was based on Christian belief and Christian faith. And in its concluding paragraph, the Declaration of Independence says, "We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America in General Congress assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions, do in the name and by the authority of the good people of these colonies, solemnly publish and declare that these united colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states." So the Founding Fathers appealed to God, the Supreme Judge of the world. They appealed to Christianity's God. The Declaration's final sentence says, "And for the support of this Declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor." So again, they were relying on God to protect them, the protection of divine providence. So they based this declaration strongly on the God of the Bible, referring to him repeatedly from beginning to end in the Declaration of Independence as nature's God, the Creator, the Supreme Judge of the world, and relying on his divine providence. In this way, the Founding Fathers made it very clear that this new nation was being founded on belief in the Christian Bible. They were looking to the God of the Bible to determine right from wrong, to guide them in their actions, and to bless their efforts. And it was the July 4th, 1776 signing of that Declaration of Independence that we celebrate by our holiday today. But our discussion of the Christian foundation of this country would not be complete without looking at one additional document. This is a letter written by John Adams, our second president. He succeeded our first president, George Washington, as the second president of the United States. Adams was one of the five men who wrote the Declaration of Independence, along with Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, and two others. As President of the United States, Adams wrote this letter to the Massachusetts militia in 1798. In that letter, he compared this country's blessings with the desolation afflicting many other lands, and he credited the continuation of those blessings on this nation's continued sincerity and piety, or religious devotion, as a Christian nation. And then he sounded a warning. He said, "But should the people of America once become capable of that deep simulation towards one another and towards foreign nations, which assumes the language of justice and moderation, while it is practicing iniquity and extravagance, and displays in the most captivating manner the charming pictures and candor, frankness and sincerity, while it is rioting and rapine and insolence, this country will be the most miserable habitation in the world." That was rather flowery language, typical of eloquent speakers of the 1700s. But what did Adams mean? He warned of the USA speaking the language of justice and moderation while it is practicing iniquity and extravagance. That meant talking the talk, but no longer walking the walk. Iniquity and extravagance means sin and self-indulgence. He warned against that. He said, "If our nation ends up rioting and rapine and insolence, this country will be the most miserable habitation in the world." Why? John Adams explained, Because we have no government armed with power capable of contending with human passions unbridled by morality and religion. Avarice, ambition, revenge, or gallantry would break the strongest cords of our Constitution as a whale goes through a net. Our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other. In other words, our Constitution was written for a moral and religious people, by which Adams meant, of course, the Christian religion. If our nation abandoned biblical morality and the religion of the Bible, our Constitution would no longer work. That was the warning sounded by America's second president, John Adams. All of this should give us pause to think about the way this nation is going today. How long will we keep our blessings and our prosperity? How long will we be able to keep saying, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord"? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you look down from the heavens and see everyone and everything. You know what's going on, Lord, throughout the world, and you know what's going on in this country that was originally founded, dedicated to you and to your word, the Bible. And yet the country has strayed so far now. We thank you, Lord, that we have these wonderful things in your word. And we pray that you'll help each of us in our own hearts to make our own decisions to walk with you, regardless of what others are doing. And we pray for the coming of our Lord and King, Jesus Christ, as we pray for your kingdom to come and your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Let's join together in singing "Onward, Christian Soldiers."
Yeah.
Heavenly Father, thank you for strengthening us through your word, the Bible, and through your spirit in our hearts to uphold your word, to speak the gospel, and to share it with others. Help us, please, Lord, to go through the week ahead with your word in our hearts and minds and your gospel on our lips. In Jesus' name, amen. God be with you till we meet again.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsel guide uphold you. With his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet, God be with you till we meet again.
Our 7 o'clock Wednesday evening remote Bible study and prayer meeting is currently on summer recess. See you next week for our Sunday morning service. God bless. Keep safe.